Today, I would like to start out by talking about two identical twin sisters. Their names were Esther Pauline and Pauline Esther. Both of them were born on the 4th of July. Both of them played the violin. Together, at the Iowa College where they attended, they studied journalism and psychology and also wrote together the gossip column for the school newspaper. 2 days before their 21st birthday, they were wed to their husbands in a double ceremony. Growing up in a home in which their mother and father were people commonly sought out by others for advice, both of them eventually became newspaper advice columnists. They are more widely known by their pen names, Ann Landers and Abigail Van Buren, also known as Dear Abby. However, something that is probably not as widely known about them is the fact that during their professional careers as columnists, they were actually estranged. It all started when the Chicago Sun-Times refused to employ them both to work together on writing the Ann Landers column. After that, one of them accepted an offer to go to work for the San Francisco Chronicle, where she subsequently started Dear Abby. With the success of both columns, the two sisters became competitors, and this led to an unavoidable rift between them. For several years, they were not even on speaking terms. And though eventually they did reconcile publicly, sources close to them have maintained that the contention between them existed for really a number of years after that. It all kind of makes me wonder how they would have handled it when letters were written to their columns on the question of sibling rivalry. In one of my more recent posts, we looked at the book of Acts, chapter 15, verses 36 through 40. It is in this passage that Paul and Barnabas are at odds with each other over the question of whether or not to take John Mark on the second missionary journey. It had been on the first missionary journey, as we read in Acts chapter 13, that John Mark had bailed on them at Perga in order to return to Jerusalem. And our passage is an illustration of how disagreements are prone to happen between all kinds of people for all kinds of reasons. Between Paul and Barnabas, there really was no peace. Things were not okay. As the text describes it, it was a sharp disagreement. It was a disagreement in which they were unable to reach consensus, at least not of the sort really necessary to be able to continue to minister together. So they chose to part company. While it's always after God's own heart to see differences between one another weathered, sometimes, nonetheless, this is a very real example of how conflict can go. In Romans 12:18, we are given this command: inasmuch as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. However, sometimes, though we may willingly propose the most reasonable of compromises, it may still not be enough. Sometimes it really is due to factors beyond our own control. Sometimes it really is a matter of the ball being in the court of the other party. And sometimes the only choice with which we are left is to move on, to not be closely associated with the other party, at least in terms of the matter concerned. It's as my dad used to say, to agree to disagree. What then? I think the answer has much to do with the attitude we choose to have about it as we move on. It was Chuck Swindoll who had this to say about attitude: the longer I live, the more I realize the impact of attitude on life. Attitude to me is more important than facts. It is more important than the past, than education, than money, then circumstances, then failure, then successes, than what other people think, say, or do. It is more important than appearance, giftedness, or skill. It will make or break a company, a church, a home. The remarkable thing is we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we will embrace for that day. We cannot change our past. We cannot change the fact that people will act in a certain way. We cannot change the inevitable. The only thing that we can do is play on the one string we have, and that is our attitude. I am convinced that life is 10% what happens to me and 90% of how I react to it. And so it is with you. We are in charge of our attitudes. It's so true. Sometimes our attitude really is the one and only string we have to play. But with my attitude, I'm 100% in charge, just as you are with your attitude. So what kind of attitude will we choose to have as we move on? Will it be an attitude of stonewalled resentment? It's only because he's a total jerk and an idiot. Forget about him. Well, she may see it that way, but I am going to see it my way. Or will it be more of an attitude of grace? As followers of Jesus, as the ones who he has said are the salt of the earth and the light of the world, which of these attitudes is more after God's own heart? With which of these attitudes are we still letting our light shine in such a way that others will see our good works and glorify God the Father in heaven? Two thoughts come to my mind. One of them is Romans 12:20. But if your enemy is hungry, give him something to eat. And if your enemy is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing so, you will be heaping burning coals upon his head. So, I happen to be in disagreement with a colleague of mine in language teaching. Does that make them a sworn enemy? Does it mean I can't be supportive to them in an unrelated matter? Is the rift so great between us that I cannot rejoice with them as they rejoice? For example, if one of them gets engaged, gets married, or has a child. Is the rift between us so great that I cannot weep with them as they weep, particularly on the question of something like serious illness or loss of a loved one? No guarantees, but I think this way really is the better tactic in terms of softening hearts and earning the right to be heard versus the way of quarreling and sour grapes. It's like that Aesop's fable of old, in which the sun and the wind looked down upon a traveler as he traveled over a road. The traveler was wearing a cloak that both the wind and the sun wanted for themselves. What did they do? The wind harshly blew a little bit of windshield factor down on the traveler. But what did the traveler do then? He only pulled the cloak tighter around himself and continued on his way. However, what happened when the sun calmly and gently shined his rays down on the traveler? Eventually, the traveler stopped to rest, and in doing so, he removed the cloak. Who got more of what they were seeking, the sun or the wind, and why? My other thought is this, that for me, disagreement is not always necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes it's helpful to me in identifying my own blind spots and evaluating more clearly where I stand and why. Is the position that I hold something I have taken more at face value because it happens to be what everyone else is saying? Or is it something that I have really taken the part to study all the elements in detail so to make up my own mind before putting it back together as a more true and firmer conviction? Sometimes it really does help me more clearly see my position and where it may need to be revised. What am I really going to live or die on? And what is my attitude going to be about it as I do? To that end, a rival's subjective begging to differ for me has actually proven to be helpful, especially in discovering where the wisdom is really to be found. How about you? And finally, I think it's important to always remember the one thing that we all ultimately have in common. It's in his image and according to his likeness that God has created us all. He loves us all. He gave his son, Jesus, to die for the sins of us all, who was then raised from the dead in victory over the sins of us all. And this is truly how it is. No matter where exactly each of us stands with regard to the question of individually and personally receiving the free gift of eternal life, which he has to offer us all in having done so. So therefore, as his witnesses, as his children, and as his followers, we absolutely can, sometimes do, and sometimes must disagree with the views of others around us, even sometimes to the point that it will shape the conditions under which we are subsequently able to interact with each other. And sometimes this even means making the choice to part ways and not be closely associated. Whether you're Ann Landers, whether you're Dear Abby, whether you're Paul, whether you're Barnabas, whether you're a teacher of world languages, or whoever, this is sometimes the hard reality of it. However, at the end of the day, it's still important to keep an attitude of grace and respect toward the other party and their point of view. In what ways might it lead to reflection and re-evaluation of where I stand, of where they stand, of where we all stand? And how about the attitude we have toward each other as we do? Whatever the nature of the contention, to the glory of God the Father.